the failure of string theory. The failure of string theory is something that's been talked about for decades before it was cool to dunk on string theory. Now it's all in vogue. Hey, I hate string theory. There were just four initial primary critics: Eric Weinstein, Lee Smolin, Peter Woit, and Sabine Hossenfelder. Though you can lump several other physics and math professors there as well, they just weren't so vocal. Okay, so what is meant when people say that string theory has failed? Okay, number one, there's a lack of experimental evidence. String theory has not provided any testable predictions that could be verified or falsified through experiments, which is a fundamental requirement for a scientific theory. This is technically false. It's provided predictions, they're just far out of the range of what we can currently test. Number two, a lack of connection to the standard model. Throughout this whole iceberg so far, I was careful to say the word quantum field theory rather than the standard model. And that's because, despite the hype, string theory is far from being a unification of the standard model with gravity. Rather, it makes compatible gravity with quantum field theory. This is decidedly different. Quantum field theory is a general framework, and it suffers from its own issues of inequivalent representations and not being rigorous, at least enough for the mathematicians. And the standard model itself is a far cry from being the unique quantum field theory. Number three, non-unique solutions. Recall, there are various possible vacua that outnumber the particles in the observable universe. Number four, academic pressure. The academic and research environment has often favored string theory, leading to pressure on physicists to conform to this framework at the expense of exploring other ideas. Number five, in terms of data showing string theory's decline as a litmus test, you can see the failure by the lack of Wikipedia entries in the history section of string theory, where every decade prior warranted its own section before the last two decades, despite thousands and thousands of more people working on string theory than ever before. It only has a single entry. Furthermore, it's the smallest entry. Number six, another data point you can use as a rough heuristic is that browsing Ed Witten's publication record on Google Scholar, you can notice a decrease in string-related articles with time. Number seven, even Ed Witten's collaborator, Edward Frankel, discusses the failure of the original promise of string theory to provide a unique theory of everything, going unacknowledged by string theory's creators over and over again. The podcast with Edward Frankel is shown on screen here and in the description. Shirk's anti-gravity. Joel Shirk is one of the founders of string theory who unfortunately died unexpectedly in tragic circumstances only months after the supergravity workshop at Stony Brook in 1979. The workshop proceedings were dedicated to his memory, with a statement that Shirk, who was diabetic, had been trapped somewhere without his insulin and went into a diabetic coma. He was only 33 years old. A year prior to his death, Shirk published a little-known paper titled Anti-Gravity, a Crazy Idea. The concept of anti-gravity emerges from the introduction of a massless vector field denoted as a mu with a superscript L, referred to as the anti-graviton. The anti-graviton couples to a conserved current, J, associated with the quarks and leptons' unclad mechanical masses. This is in contrast with the graviton, which interacts with their actual masses. A force between two atoms can be expressed as F equals this formula on screen, where M and M0 are the real and unclad masses respectively, and G is the gravitational constant. You may be wondering, doesn't this notion of anti-gravity clash with the equivalence principle? It seems to, but this clash can be resolved if a scalar field acquires a non-zero vacuum expectation value similar to how SU2 cross SU1 breaks down into U1. This causes the L field to acquire a mass term, which changes the potential into one with a different minimum. Shirk showed that this anti-gravity is a quality of any extended supersymmetric gravitational model. This paper has received little attention, and no one that I personally know in the string community, other than say David Chester, has mentioned it. Actually, there are conflicting stories about Shirk's death. A friend of his noted that Shirk suffered a breakdown. His wife left with their children, and he later committed suicide. Here, I'd like to make a note. Depending on your background, much of this math may sound unintelligible, it may sound like gibberish, that's okay. It's important not that you drink from the fire hose, but rather that you merely get wet. In other words, don't feel dismayed if you don't understand Spanish from the get-go. Rather, immerse yourself in Spain, for instance, and that, along with a bit of practice, will advance you. Even John von Neumann said, "The point of math isn't to understand it, but rather to get used to it." You would think that Fields medalist Richard Borchards would need only a single book to understand commutative algebra, but instead he had to learn about it not from one source, not from two, not three, but eight. This video itself took me 2 months to write, and even here I'm barely scratching the surface. If you're interested in advanced math or physics or philosophy, just stick with it. Don't be concerned that certain concepts go over your head. What goes over your head today, you'll be able to eat for breakfast in 1 year. Prioritize general acclimation over minute comprehension.
Loop quantum gravity. LQG is a non-perturbative background independent quantum gravity framework reconciling quantum mechanics and general relativity. It employs Ashtakar variables representing the gravitational field via an SU2 connection A and its conjugate E. The last one is called a densitized triad. Spin networks are graphs with vertices labeled with an intertwiner I and edges by irreducible representations J of SU2 form the foundation of loop quantum gravity. Just like the motivation for string theory, loop is also quite simple mathematically speaking. And also, like string theory, its humble beginnings belie its subsequent tortuous flowering. Loop quantum gravity creates the Hilbert space basis of gravitational field quantum states, each representing a quantized 3 geometry for the 3 spatial dimensions. Discrete spectra come about for area A and volume V operators, given on screen here, where gamma is the Barbaro-Immerse parameter, and L is, of course, the Planck length. Transition amplitudes between spin networks originate from spin foam evaluation, modifying the famous quantum field theoretic path integral technique. Loop quantum gravity was developed or discovered, depending on your philosophical framework, in the 80s by Ashtakar, Rovelli, and Smolin. Plenty of work was also done in the 90s by John Bias as well. To this day, it's seen as an antagonist to string theory, but Lee Smolin told me in a recent podcast just last week that string theory and loop quantum gravity are two sides of the same coin. Quantum entanglement. One of the most astounding subjects in modern pop sci is quantum entanglement with its ostensible faster-than-light signaling. Let's explore this by starting with entropy. If we take the von Neumann entropy, where rho is the reduced density matrix, then the holographic entropy, which includes the Ryu-Takayanagi formula as a special case, connects the entanglement entropy with the area of a minimal surface gamma. This relationship gave rise to the so-called ER equals EPR conjecture or heuristic, whatever you want to call it. But what does this mean? It suggests that entangled pairs of particles are equivalent to wormholes. Now, if that wasn't remarkable enough, it has the further implication that space-time geometry itself emerges from the entanglement structure of underlying quantum states. But what about that firewall argument? That one that suggests a breakdown of the equivalence principle at the black hole event horizon due to maximal entanglement. The firewall argument, well, it was proposed by 4 researchers named Almhury, Miralf, Palczynski, and Sully, abbreviated as AMPS, raises concerns about the validity of ER equals EPR. According to AMPS, a black hole that's maximally entangled with another system, for instance Hawking radiation, can't also be entangled with its own interior, as that would violate the so-called monogamy of entanglement principle. Consequently, the smooth space-time structure near the horizon, as predicted by general relativity, would break down, and the observer would experience a firewall instead. This argument has led to this huge debate among physicists, with some proposing possible resolutions such as the soft hair proposal by Hawking, Perry, and Strominger, or the idea of state dependence, which states that the experience of an observer falling into a black hole depends on the specific quantum state of the system. This is all fascinating and highly speculative. Let me know if you'd like me to do an iceberg on black holes.
If you enjoyed this toe clipping, then the full video is linked in the description. You should also sign up for Toe Mail, which is again in the description and the pinned comment. You'll receive immediate access to all exclusive updates from the Theories of Everything podcast. It also helps me communicate directly with the core Toe community. You'll also receive my top 10 toes. Think of it as the intellectual version of Quentin Tarantino's obsession.